come on, amen. You may have a seat. Praise the Lord. Can we say thank you to the worship team, please? Amen. So good. So good. I'm seeing a lot more Steeler gear right now. This is what I'm seeing. Like this morning, packed. I think it was like 99% Steeler fans that were here. And now I'm just seeing a lot more gear. I'm a fan, man. I appreciate Steeler Nation showing up to BC. I think we're going to make the Super Bowl. That's just my guess. That's not prophesied. That's just a hope and a dream. It is a dream. I think we have a rough road ahead. But there's change coming, baby. Come on. What's up, beautiful? How are
you? Good morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
Yes.
How are you?
Good.
Give me a smooch. Okay. Love you. Come on. Hey, I've asked Renee just to come pray over me. And then when Renee shows up with her phone, she's got like a message to preach. I'm like, honey, I got to preach today. She's like, honey, I got a word. I'm like, oh boy, here we go. What do you got, baby?
Amen.
Love it.
God is good. It's just great to see you all this morning. And so I was just saying that in the first service that Sean and I were just together this week, and he was reading the word, and I just am thankful for a husband who washes me with the word. You know, the Bible says to wash her with the word, and just what a blessing it is to have a husband who, you know, reads the word over us, you know, me and my children. And but we were reading about just how the word cleanses. And when you delight yourself in the word, and the word is washing over you, it consecrates you, it cleanses you, and it makes you holy. And this song this morning about, you know, make me a vessel, Lord, make me a vessel that can be used of you. And I just was remembering that, you know, God is so good, and he needs us to be washed clean. He needs us to be that place where he can fill us. How Sean is preaching on spiritual gifts, if we want these spiritual gifts to be filled inside of us where the Holy Spirit dwells, you know, then we have to be ready, okay, and be in that place where we're ready to be filled. And I was just thinking, too, when we were singing that in the second service, it's kind of like, you know, when I'm in the Word and Sean and I are reading and, you know, together and even privately, you know, when the Word washes over you, and just how, you know, we're talking about like being a vessel and how new wine is put into new wineskins. I was thinking how when you open like a bottle of soda, it bubbles up. And it's almost like bursting out. And that's what happens when you're in the Word and you're delighting yourself in the Word. You're like, you get all bubbled up inside and you're like, who can I tell this to? This is amazing. This is so cool. So anyway, that was my little, you know, get to that point where you're just like bubbling up and you just want to run and tell somebody like, this is a word and it's amazing. But in 1 Corinthians 6, it says, do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit who is within you, whom you have received as a gift from God, and that you are not your own? You're not your own property. You were bought with a price. You were actually purchased with the precious blood of Jesus and made his own. So then honor and glorify God with your body. And I said in the first service, too, you know, I was thinking about how Jesus in his ministry, he went into the temple and he overturned the tables and he was like, get everything unclean out of here. Like, he went with force. And it's the same today. You know, Jesus is here with us, his Holy Spirit, and we now are the temple of the Holy Spirit. And as I just want to pray, as Sean is washing us with the water of the word, it will cleanse us and it will take everything that's unclean and unholy out of us, so then we are able to be filled with that new wine, and that we'll be bursting with the good news. And that's why we're here, to like share it with others that need to hear the good news. So amen. Let's pray.
Let's go.
Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for Sean. We thank you, Lord, that you have given him to us, the body of Christ, as a gift, Lord, that you say that you will give shepherds according to your heart, that, Lord, he has the word of God inside of him, Lord. It's bursting. It's ready to come out. Father, we thank you that you have anointed him to preach the good news today, Lord, that as he preaches on spiritual gifts, Lord, that we will be ready and excited to hear, Lord God, the gifts, Lord, that you have ready for us. And so I just pray, God, that you will bless this word today, Lord, that you will fill him with all power and that he will rightly divide this word of truth, Lord, that we will hear from your spirit, God, that we will hear from our Father today, and that, God, we thank you that you will bless your people here at Believers Chapel, Lord, that you will pour out your spirit on Believers Chapel, Lord, and that, Father, as we delight yourself in you, Lord, that you say you will give us every good thing, Lord. So, God, I just pray, Lord, that you will pour out your spiritual gifts on your people today. In Jesus' name, amen.
I do want to share from the first service. As she was, as Renee was speaking in the first service, and I haven't said this to her at home at all, this really is, I believe, just a word for Renee. I want to share with the whole church where, Renee does so much behind the scenes. She does so much in prayer. And I look at when Peter was in jail and he was locked up, and there was a prayer meeting taking place at Mary's house. And Mary was, we take it as Mary was the lead, and she had this house full of people. And the only ones mentioned in the story are females. I'm sure there was males there, but just the ones mentioned are females. And they were praying, and they were praying, and they were praying, and they were praying. And in their prayers, they were praying for Peter's release. And it was miraculous how Peter was released. And Peter shows up to Mary's house where they're praying. And there's a great story there. But Renee, as I said this in the first service, when you were speaking and reading, girl, not just because you're my wife, but because I see you behind the scenes and I see what you do in prayer and I see what you do in your prayer meeting and I see where you need to know this, and I believe this, that you truly are a spiritual weapon. Like, no, it's true. Like, you don't like this at all, the public, but you do so much behind the scenes that I really see you as a spiritual weapon. And I see you as one who is doing such great damage in the darkness, in the kingdom of darkness. And there is so much light that is coming forth. And you got to stay firm and stay strong and stay praying and lead these ladies in your prayers. And you are a weapon. And God is using you in a powerful, powerful way. And I'm pumped to get you strapped up in a gun belt and put on some guns and let's go to work. Come on, weapon. Amen. I love you. That's my wife, ladies and gentlemen. That is my girl. Come on. I just saw that as she was speaking in the first service, that she is truly a spiritual weapon, and I love this. Come on, let's get into this. We got a lot to cover in a short time because we got to get this finished. I am going to go Facebook Live this week and cover one of these topics. I just don't have the time to hit it the way I want to, but I really need to get into Luke 2. Next week, we start talking on Christmas. And we look to Luke 2, and we're going to look at what does it mean to have peace on the earth. And then I love it for the 19th. Our big theme is to believe that God is with us and Emmanuel, and to dive deep into that. It's going to be so powerful in all kind of different places where we see God is with us. And when we know that God is with us, there should be this great place of joy and this great strength and this great trust when we believe in the Christmas story. That God came to earth and he is with us and he remains with us by his spirit. And we're gonna mention briefly even what Renee read in 1 Corinthians 6, so I don't have to turn there. One of the big ideas for this morning is we're gonna look at prophecy, the gift of prophecy. We're gonna look at tongues very briefly. I will speak more on tongues during my Facebook Live this week so I can have more time to dive into some things. And then we're gonna look at what it really means to be filled with the Holy Spirit or baptized in the Holy Spirit. And I hope to have time to really open that up for us to understand that. I have loved this series. The purpose of this series, there's a lot of times we don't have a lot of series on going through all of the spiritual gifts from Romans 12 and 1 Corinthians 12. But I thought it was just necessary for Believers Chapel. And I love what God's doing here. Church, we are so blessed. We have so many people coming to church. We have so many new families coming to church. We are really believing for a children's ministry of 200 a week 200 every week we want in our children's ministry. We have the space. We have the quality of people. We've got the best volunteers. We've got a team that's ready to go. And I believe God will bring out 200. That means families. That means husbands and wives. Right? I'm pumped about our college ministry. I'm pumped about our high school ministry. And I'm pumped about youth ministry. There's so much that's happening at Believers Chapel. I am juiced, man. I'm excited. We are in a great place as the body of Christ. We're pumped about our local little tiny sliver of the big body. But in this series, man, I'm excited to for even new people. And I'm excited for those that really have come and they've been soaking, but it's now time to start giving. And it's now time to start getting in the game. And it's now time to exercise the gift that God's given me, whether it is a serving gift or a leadership gift. And we've gone through all of these gifts. But I believe that it unifies the body. Like, spiritual gifts are not for you. It's for the edification and the building of the body. Spiritual gifts are the gifts as the Spirit wills to give, as He desires to give. There's a misunderstanding. If I pray over you, then you will have a spiritual gift. No, they're given by the Spirit of God. Now, there can be praying over you where your gift is now recognized, but it's not giving by that prayer. It's given by the Holy Spirit. So I've wanted to make so many things here in this series to be very clear, to be very clear. Watch this now. I want it to be very clear in a doctrine that is more of an open-handed doctrine here at Believers Chapel. There's closed fist doctrine that there's no wiggle room. Jesus is the only way. The Trinity is absolute. It's only by the blood of Christ. We absolutely believe in creation and creation alone. And there's a lot of things that we could go through that are very much closed fist. And there's no other wiggle room and no debate. And I love this. We're even this week for pastors that are in Believers Chapel and gentlemen that I trust that even have a different opinion on this than I do, which I love that. And we have this understanding of, I'm going to preach it as I see it, as a continuist and not a cessationist. Cessation means that some of these gifts has ceased. They believe the healing gift has ceased. Tongues have ceased. Prophecy have ceased. These are the gifts that they say have ceased. I firmly believe that they are continuing. These are people that we love. These are people in many different ministries that I soak in from, that I have commentaries from, that I love. They love Jesus. These are brothers of mine around, you know, around the world that I trust, that I glean from, that have more of a view of certain gifts have ceased. I personally can't see that in Scripture. I don't find that. They pull out one or two verses and I disagree. But they love Jesus and their brothers and sisters in Christ. So I'm a fan of that. But today we get to talk about some things that I have seen, I've experienced. As you know, my testimony, I come from a place of at times neglect of the Holy Spirit and the spiritual gifts. And then I've gone all the way to the side of extreme abuse of spiritual gifts and the Holy Spirit. We're teaching over here is way, way off base biblically. And teaching over here on the neglect side is non-existent. It's God the Father, God the Son, and the distant cousin. Like when they mention Holy Spirit, people get weird in these type of churches where the Holy Spirit isn't mentioned and talked about and is in a place of neglect. That's not okay. And then this over here, the place where you can do anything you want to do as long as you call it the Holy Spirit. That's not okay either. So God has allowed me to be in both on this amazing journey to pastor and lead Believers Chapel, where we have always held this position of this middle ground. I consider myself a conservative charismatic. Not Pentecostal. Sometimes you say Pentecostal, your mind can go to some weirdness. And I'm not picking on them. I'm just saying at minds when you say that, I use the word charismatic, and I'm a very conservative, very much in the middle charismatic. And I like that because I think there's a great balance. I think there's a great balance in Scripture. So please, when this is the way we see it here at Believers Chapel, and we want a great balance. So as we begin to speak on what prophecy is, and I'm going to give a definition of prophecy, though I really believe it in Scripture. And then we're going to get into the tongues briefly, which I can sum tongues up in a sentence. I've already had people ask me, even during spiritual gifts, do you believe that all are supposed to pray in tongues? Am I missing something if I'm not praying in tongues? Because there's people in my world that are just, they keep pressing tongues on me, that you're supposed to pray in tongues, you're supposed to pray in tongues, you're supposed to pray in tongues. What's wrong with you? Well, you're supposed to have this spiritual gift. If, quote, you've been baptized in the Holy Spirit, you're supposed to pray in other tongues. And today we're going to kind of put a stop on that. And realize the very simple question is Paul actually asks the question, will all use the spiritual gift of tongues? And the answer is no. And it's amazing because the side that likes to abuse spiritual gifts, they always make tongues the priority. You ever notice that? It's always the priority. It's always the question. Well, have you been filled with the Spirit? Have you been baptized in the Holy Spirit with the evidence of speaking in tongues? I cannot even tell you how many times I've heard that. Baptized in the Holy Spirit with the evidence of speaking in tongues, which that's not really clear in Scripture at all. They use four places in Acts, which that's what I'm going to get into more in Facebook Live, is breaking down Acts 2, Acts 8, Acts 10, Acts 19, and looking at that spiritual gift and see what it says. That would just take up way too much time today. But to answer the quick question on the spiritual gift of tongues, Will, is it a gift for today? I do believe it is. And I believe we're not called to forbid it. I believe it could be in a specific setting at a specific time. But it's not for, I believe, the public brothers and sister meeting on a Sunday. I don't believe it's for that. I think that causes confusion. I think people would walk in and think that we've been smoking some bad stuff. So we need to be very careful on that, right? So with that, yes, I do believe that we're not going to forbid tongues in the proper setting. But I don't even know if they are for specific settings, because tongues means languages, and there's a lot to that, which I'm excited to break that down more time on Facebook Live. And I'll record it this week. You guys can watch it anytime on Facebook. But our tongues for today, I do believe they are. Will everyone speak in tongues? No. If you don't have that gift, watch this, please hear me. Are you less than? No. That's the problem with this extreme side, that they live in this arena of have and have nots. I have and you don't. And all of a sudden, it just presents this arrogance. I have it and you don't, and you need to get it to be like me. Now I've been in that, I've seen that, and I don't believe that's biblically accurate at all, because the Bible says what the Holy Spirit actually does is brings unity to the body, and this is the whole purpose of this series on spiritual gifts is to unify this body and to get us in the game, and to get us in the game. So with that, let's look at 1 Corinthians 14, please. 1 Corinthians 14, we'll be in 1 Thessalonians here in a minute. You can turn there as well. And I'm excited to get into the baptism of the Holy Spirit. There's terms of the baptism in the Holy Spirit, being filled with the Holy Spirit, the anointing of the Holy Spirit, the power of the Holy Spirit. And then, you know, you scramble all that up and say, what does this mean? And we're going to talk about that and hopefully make that crystal clear this morning. But look at this. I want to talk about prophecy. Because as we see so many places in Scripture that we are called to function in prophecy. And you got to understand something. You've got Dr. David Jeremiah, the women's ministry is going to do a Bible study in that. Dr. David Jeremiah is a genius, and it is one of his special areas of communication is Bible prophecy. Biblical prophecy, Bible prophecy is not what we're talking about today. Bible prophecy, he so amazingly breaks down the book of Daniel, breaks down the book of Ezekiel, breaks down the book of Revelation, things that are already written down for us that God says this is going to happen. That's Bible prophecy. God says it's going to happen, hasn't happened yet. And that's biblical prophecy, that you take a gentleman like Dr. David Jeremiah that can just shred that and crush that and do amazing with that. And you're just like, oh, that's what the 10 horns means. I get it. Wow, it's amazing. What a picture. He's brilliant, right? Love that. That's Bible prophecy. That's not what we're speaking on today. And there's two different areas of this, and I'm kind of in the middle of both, where there's the foretelling and the forthtelling. The foretelling is speaking things of future. Now, this is, please hear me, this is kind of where the Fruit Loops come in at times. This is where the gift of prophecy can be very much abused. This is on the abuse side. At times, I do believe that God can speak to somebody about things that will take place. But I think people, watch this now, I think there's been so many that have used this for their own agenda. Well, God said, God just told me this. When I hear that, just so you know, a red flag goes up for me. And I got to be honest with you, just being transparent, when I came out of the school of abuse, it took me a while. It took, and God knew what he was doing, because it took me a while, a couple years before really starting Believer's Chapel, that I didn't want anything to have to do with it because I saw crazy and I saw the abuse. Well, and I think there's many in this church that at times may have seen the abuse, and then it causes us to want to go to the side of neglect automatically because I saw that, I don't like that, that's scary. I know that's not right, it's not biblically accurate. Things of crazy, people think it's crazy because it is crazy. I want to be on this side because watch this. When there's neglect, it's safe. I got to be honest with you, I kind of had to travel a little bit to get me back in the middle. Because over here, to be a cessationist, it's safe. But I don't think it's proper biblically. But it's safe. When you get into the abuse of prophecy, it can just get out of the box and you get a bunch of lug nuts and they start just saying, God told me this and God said this and God just told me this and God told me this and God told me that and God told me that you and me are going to be married. Well, I don't even know your name. I know, but God just told me that we're going to be married. Run away from that individual. Punch him first and then run away because he's a creeper. And report him to me, please. I mean that. If you have a dude in this church going, God just told me to marry you, then you report him to me after you physically harm him. You come report him to me. Because that's crazy. And I've also been where I've seen it, and it has such a distaste in my mouth where there are ministers who will use, God just told me it, God just said this, and they use it, watch this, they use it for their own gain. They use it to add credibility to what they're trying to sell. Because who can argue, right? Well, if God told you, I guess no. You know, one of the Ten Commandments is do not take the Lord's name in vain. It's the third of the Ten Commandments. Do not take the Lord's name in vain. Church, that doesn't necessarily mean the GD word. That necessarily does mean those who will take the name of the Lord and use it in a vain way. And that is to their own advantage. So we're not speaking of that camp of the prophetic. How many, maybe you even bought into it, and I hope that we didn't, and I hope that it's been very well corrected now, a year after the election, that many were prophesying, the Lord told me that Trump's going to win. The Lord told me that Trump's, have no fear, church, Trump is going to win because God told me. How many, don't raise your hands, but how many saw that and maybe even bought into that a little bit, and today we know that that's not the case. And when you see that, I'm like, your credibility is a bit toast. Credibility goes a long way. So do I believe in the foretelling? I do believe there could be moments, and I don't want to ever shorthand the power of God. Are there moments that God can show and reveal something that could happen? Yes, I believe that because we see that biblically. But there's caution to that and be very careful. But I also believe that on a more day-to-day arena of prophecy, I believe this. I believe we're going to look at it in 1 Corinthians 14. I just want to give you the definition first so we can see it. And again, sitting down with the pastors of this church and just, I love this. I love studying this because I've studied so deeply on the cessationist view and I know that position and I know the verses they use and I know what they come up with. And then I've studied the continuous, and I've done this for years now, the continuous position and why I do stand in a continuous side as a conservative charismatic. And I think that the gifts have continued to see people by the great hand of God do great works. And speaking with people and just even our own pastors here in this church, you've got Pastor Al and Pastor Jerry and Pastor Steve and another friend of mine and just kind of sitting down and talking and going over. And I love the definition of prophecy is this, is it's God having a conversation with somebody through an ordinary person. Watch this. What is it that you prophesy to somebody? What is it that you would have a word for somebody? And again, I believe that was even for Renee this morning. Like I didn't say that at home. That wasn't like in our devotion time. I really felt in that moment that I had a word for Renee that she is a spiritual weapon. And she needs to know that and not second guess that. But what happens when it's God Almighty wanting to have a conversation with somebody? and he uses you to do it. Now that could be, I think most of it is through the word of God. I think every week we prophesy here, we teach the word. I think it happens in our children's ministry. It happens in Breakaway. It happens. Every ministry that we have is Bible foundation. Every ministry we have is Bible-based and Bible's being taught. It's a conversation that God wants to have with an individual, and it happens through ordinary people. And there's times that it's like, God, why couldn't you just tell me that? And I believe this. Maybe God has been trying. Because I believe that, and please hear me on this. Again, we're speaking on the gift of prophecy. When someone speaks a true word over you, wow, already, Katie, unbelievable. You move the clock forward, Katie. Please hear me, we got a cruise. We're gonna be here a few minutes, it's all good. I believe this, that if somebody has a true word for you, that it really is a word of prophecy, that God is trying to have a conversation with me, and this has happened, where somebody will come to me and say, listen, I'm not saying thus saith the Lord, but I do believe that this is something that maybe God impressed on my heart. I might be wrong, but I believe this is a word of prophecy for you. And then they speak to me and it is just like, it's a zinger. You know what I mean by a zinger? It just hits you in the heart and you're just like, yeah. It brings more confirmation, I think, than anything. I believe the simple definition of prophecy, it can be foretelling, but I think it's also forthtelling of his word. Please hear this, that it's just a conversation that God wants to have with somebody and he uses you to get there. Watch this, look at this, 1 Corinthians 14, verse 1. Pursue love, and again, we've talked about in the first message that we looked at 1 Corinthians 13 being right in the middle of all of the gifts, because there's a purpose of love being absolute focus and center. Love has to be the foundation here. It says pursue. Pursue, it means to go after. Pursue, go after love. Yet, watch this, desire earnestly. I love that. What does cessation is do with this? Desire earnestly spiritual gifts, but especially, watch this, especially, there's one that kind of floats to the top, especially that you may prophesy. Desire earnestly. Pursue, go after, chase down love. But desire earnestly. There's a depth to that. Spiritual gifts. So even in this series and in this teaching, I want us to desire spiritual gifts and open ourselves up that the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit, will begin to reveal to us the gift that he's given us, so it is to get in the game for the betterment of the body to build up his kingdom. That's the purpose. And watch what he says here. He talks about tongues in verse 2. For one who speaks in a tongue does not speak to men, but to God. For no one understands, but in his spirit he speaks mysteries. That's the possibly praying in tongues. And we'll talk on that on Facebook. Verse 3 says this. Watch this. Watch this. This is huge to our conversation today. Because there's three things that a true word of prophecy we'll take care of. There's three areas here if it's a true word of prophecy. It says this, watch this. But one who prophesies speaks to men. Again, one who prophesies speaks. There's participation in this. We are a part, watch this, please hear me. We're a part of prophecy. Prophecy has to be spoken. And what is it? Hear me, please. We've defined prophecy, but what's the purpose of prophecy? The definition is that God wants to have a conversation with somebody, but he uses you to get there. Well, what is that conversation? Watch this. What is a word of prophecy? When it's spoken, it does three things. Highlight these, check these off, write these down. It edifies, it exhorts, and it consults. It edifies. If it's a true prophecy, the Bible says it edifies, it builds up. When you speak to somebody a word of prophecy, it does something to their spirit that it builds them. It exhorts them. That means that it encourages. You've got it builds up and that it encourages somebody. What happens when you speak And you know that, listen, I do believe that this is from the Lord. I believe that, but this isn't thus saith the Lord. This isn't exactly his words, but I want to speak this. I believe this of God. Please check it. Like whenever I'm functioning this, I always say, listen, please check this. And if this confirms, great. If not, listen, then it was me. That's where you've got to be careful on that. But what does prophecy do? It builds, it edifies, it encourages. Exhortation means that it brings encouragement. And then the third thing, it brings comfort. Remember, when it's a true prophecy, it will be more confirming than anything. It wouldn't be like a surprise. It'd be more confirming. And it does something where it brings comfort. Now, let me ask you this. Let's try this. What happens if this week you say, God, do I really have this gift of prophecy? Because what is it to be used by you this week? That whether I'm in the grocery store, and please don't make it weird in the grocery store. Whether you're at work, or whether you're at home, or whether you're a husband or a wife, or whether you're a parent, or whether you're even a child and you've got a word for your parents, like that can happen. What, God, would you have me speak to somebody this week that would bring encouragement to them? A friend and I were out to breakfast yesterday at a restaurant, and just the gentleman came up and just started having a conversation with us and just kind of going through just a little bit of his short season. And the question, it was the short season of where he's at right now, physically and health-wise. And it opened the door to have a conversation. Sir, do you have a clear conscience with the Lord? Do you know where you're at with Jesus? And then that opened up to me and my friend praying over this gentleman right at the table. Like, we didn't make it weird. But we want to be able to speak life and comfort and encourage and build, no matter where you're at. What happens if you say, God, would you have a word for me today for somebody? Like, what would you have me say? And maybe you're going in to pray, and every service, if anybody needs prayer, we want to pray over you here up front. And I want our prayer team to be asking the Lord beforehand, God, what would you have me to say? Is there anything that you would have me to say to them? Church, it's not complicated, right? People make prophecy so complicated, and it really isn't that complicated. When you know the definition, and then you know the purpose. And when you see the purpose, that uncomplicates the crazy. That uncomplicates the crazy. And then you see where, let's just turn there. You can keep your finger in 1 Thessalonians 4 because I just want to show you. 1 Thessalonians, I mean, yeah, turn to 1 Thessalonians, keep your finger in 1 Corinthians. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 says this. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. Again, this is the same author. This is Paul. He writes to the church at Thessalonica, and he writes this. This is amazing. I want you to see this. Verse 16, rejoice always. Pray without ceasing. In everything give thanks, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Do not quench the Spirit. This side over here, the Holy Spirit isn't mentioned. It's the distant cousin that we don't want to talk about because we're in a safe place. They're not allowing the Spirit of our God, who is all powerful, to move and bring unity to the body, and they quench the Spirit. And then over here, it's the Fruit Loop land. The lug nuts just, we can do anything we want to do. And just, if we tag the Spirit on it, because we don't want to quench the Spirit. And they do whatever they want to, and it's a dangerous place. It's not healthy. It's an unhealthy place. So at Believer's Chapel, we want to be open to say, God, you can do whatever you choose to do because you are God. If you choose to heal, we would love to see when we pray over the sick that they would heal. God, we want to see your miraculous, and miracles means working of power. God, we want to see your working of power here at Believers Chapel. God, we want to see a word of knowledge or a word of wisdom. God, we want to see those with a spiritual gift of serving getting in the game. God, we want to see those with a spiritual gift of giving, giving far above and beyond, so that, God, we can continue to do the work that you've called us to do. We want to see those who have a, and we can go down this big long list, but we don't want to ever quench the spirit. We don't want to dampen what God wants to do. And that's why I believe that we're in a really healthy place here at Believers Chapel. It says this, do not quench the spirit. Do not despise prophetic utterance. Again, this is a letter to a whole nother church that says, listen, don't despise prophetic utterance. And we'll see in 1 Corinthians 14 that if someone does speak a prophecy over you, it needs to be tested. If someone does speak a word to you, it needs to be tested. If it is a foretelling word, it needs to be tested. But we're not called to despise prophetic utterance, but examine everything carefully. Hold fast to that which is good. Do not despise prophetic utterance, but examine it. Hold fast to that which is good. Abstain from every form of evil. Now may the God of peace himself sanctify you. I love what Renee was saying, that we are the temple of the Holy Spirit. That, watch this, we're going here. That which he dwells in you. We're going to cover that in a minute. That which he is in you. Sanctify you entirely, that you soul, your spirit, your soul, and your body may be preserved complete without blame at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Faithful is he who calls you, and he will bring it to pass. Now, I want to look at where we're at here in this church in regards to the word baptism of the Holy Spirit. You see baptism of the Holy Spirit. You see the filling of the Holy Spirit, the anointing of the Holy Spirit, the power of the Holy Spirit. All of these are a definition of the Holy Spirit working. And if you're in 1 Corinthians 14, just turn right over to 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 13. And I touched this briefly a couple weeks ago, but I just kind of want to get into it a little bit more because, again, being in both camps, man, I have seen where the question is presented, are you baptized in the Holy Spirit with the evidence of speaking in tongues? And you only really see that evidence of speaking in tongues in four places, Acts 2, 8, 10, and 19, which I will cover this week on Facebook. So what does it really mean? Like, people ask, are you a spirit-filled church? You're not a spirit-filled church. Are you a spirit-filled church? And, you know, in grace and love, with pointed boots, you're like, what? You're an idiot. What are you? Are you a spirit-filled church? If people are in this church who love Jesus, the Spirit of God is filling this church. Like, again, it's that arrogance of the have and have-nots. That's where that comes from. And it's amazing that the Holy Spirit is called to unify the body, and they actually use it as a tool to divide the body. God, be so careful here. And I was in that, and I never liked it. I'm like, no, I don't know. That's not really, So what does it really mean to be baptized in the Holy Spirit? Because there will be those who will claim that, you listen, you got to walk up front. If you haven't been baptized in the Holy Spirit, you need to walk up front, and we're going to lay hands on you, and then you're going to be filled with the Holy Spirit. And my immediate question through the years of being in that, like, well, where was I before? And you have my Nana. I heard this about my Nana, who was an evangelist in the 20s at 9 years old in Pittsburgh. At 13, they put her on a train from Pittsburgh to Seattle, and she would win a tree to Jesus. Unbelievable power of God in her life. She was articles written in the New York Times about my grandmother. She's in books about that age of this female evangelist, this girl evangelist at 9 and 13, and just the things that my Nana would do. Powerful. You take a Billy Graham, powerful. And I've heard the arrogance of statements on both my Nana and Billy Graham. Well, could you imagine if they were spirit-filled what they could accomplish? What? And I just look at these people and say, you are so backwards on what you think. We see in 1 Corinthians 12:13, because I don't believe for a moment that you have to walk up front and there's this, watch this, there's this one time special extra event that if I pray over you that you would be filled with the Spirit, then all of a sudden there's this zapping moment and now forever you're just filled with the Holy Spirit. I don't see that in Scripture. There's a few places, but it's Acts is a transitional book. Acts is the start of the church age. You have the Jewish Pentecost in Acts 2. You've got the Samaritan Pentecost in Acts 8. Then you've got the Gentile Pentecost in Acts 10. Then you got a number of 12 people who had that same experience. And again, I will cover this more, but you have to understand that it's not this, when you come forward, I pray over you, then zap, all of a sudden, okay, now you have the Holy Spirit. Well, where was I before? Did I not have the Holy Spirit before? Did I have just less than you do? Please show me in Scripture where I have less of the Holy Spirit than you do. Please show me where I walk in less power. Because then you just bring this have and have nots, and it brings division and it brings arrogance, which is absolutely contrary and opposite of who we are called to be in Christ. And you look at 1 Corinthians 12, verse 13, it says this. For by one Spirit we were all baptized. Here's the word. We were all baptized into one body. For by one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, whether Jews or Greek, whether slaves or free. We were all made to drink of one Spirit. This is the event that when you get saved, the Holy Spirit baptizes you into the church. I got a few minutes. I want to hit this. This is the event that when you get saved, the Holy Spirit then baptizes you. The word baptize, it means to immerse you. He immerses you into the church. Now you are part of the body of Christ because you have been baptized into the church. There's one event. Now I believe that when you get saved, even what Renee read today in 1 Corinthians 6, that you are the temple of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is in you. Now watch this, Romans 8, please. I'm going to cover a couple verses, Romans 8, because I believe that this is one event, but I believe that when you get saved, yes, he baptizes you in the church, but watch this. You can't get saved without the work of the Holy Spirit. Watch this. However, you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if indeed the Spirit of God what dwells in you. If the Spirit of God dwells, that's the Holy Spirit. The word dwells, it means to remain. It literally means to pitch a tent. If you go deep in that word dwells, it means to pitch a tent. He's not going anywhere. He remains. Where? In you. But if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he does not belong to him. Now, please don't equate the Spirit of Christ with the evidence of speaking in tongues. That's not what this is talking about. That there's nowhere to be found like that. In this context, but we see that the Holy Spirit dwells, he remains, he pitches a tent in us. Nowhere do we see that it's 50%. And one of the statements that we have made for this whole series is that simplicity of understanding. Church, please hear me. It's not how much you have of the Holy Spirit. It's how much the Holy Spirit has of you. This is a game of surrender. This is a game of how much do I allow him to control my life? It's not like I pray over you once and all of a sudden, bang, you're superhero Jesus. Like that's such a game, dangerous game to be played. But no, when I get saved, the Holy Spirit comes and dwells and remains in me. I am the temple of the Holy Spirit. Please hear me. It's now a message of control. How much control do I give to him that is already here? Right, that's so important. This is so important to this, and I want you to be able to really see this. Right? Could you put 2 Timothy, please? I love this. Guard through the Holy Spirit who what? Dwells in us. We are supposed to guard what? The treasure. The treasure is the gospel, the word of God. That is to be treasured. That is to be guarded. Guard through the Holy Spirit who dwells in us, who pitches a tent, who remains in us, the treasure which you have been entrusted, right? The treasure which has been entrusted to you. That's the gospel. That's the truth. That's the word. But you see it again here. Where the Holy Spirit dwells and remains in us. So I believe in the baptism of the Holy Spirit, that one-time event that when you get saved, he is the one who immerses you and you are now put into the body of Christ. But I also believe at conversion, when you've come to this place of salvation, the Holy Spirit comes in, remains, dwells, what? Not in 50%. You don't need this second act of grace, as they would call it, because that's not in Scripture. Be careful with this. We don't roll that way. And there's people that we love that do. Love them. Do they love Jesus? Absolutely. Do I feel like they got this wrong? I feel like they got it wrong. They'd say the same thing about me. We can high-five each other, have lunch, and have a great day. They love Jesus. But then we close with this. Ephesians 5 says this. Ephesians 5 says this. And I love this because this kind of is the control piece. Like if he dwells within me, he remains within me. Just because someone would pray over me and now all of a sudden you've received the Holy Spirit. No, I received him at conversion. It's a matter of how much control he's given me in my life. Like how much have I given over to him? Because I love Ephesians 5. It says this, do not get drunk with wine, for it is dissipation, but be filled with the Spirit. And it's amazing when you put these two together. It says both are controlling agents. Watch this. When you fill your body with wine, you are intoxicated. That means you are under its control. And when you're under its control, sometimes it doesn't go well for you. But what does it mean to don't get drunk with wine? That's speaking about you being under the wine's control, that alcohol or that influence under its control. Guess what? Please hear me. When you stop drinking wine or alcohol, you're no longer under its control. I want you to see the pattern here. This is so important. Man, we got just a couple minutes. Please stick with me. Are we good? I want to close with this. Are we good? All right, give me a couple minutes, please. Thank you for your patience. I just got to get this done today. And I love this because when you look at, okay, I'm no longer under control because I'm no longer drinking of alcohol, right? And again, you know my story. I'm not going to get into it. Not my story. Do I believe a glass of wine at dinner with your wife is totally okay? Yes, I'm not in that side of all alcohol sin. I'm not in that, right? Being drunk is a sin. Don't get drunk, period. If you want to have a glass of wine or whatever, high five. So don't confuse that with what I'm saying, please. You're under the control, the influence of alcohol when you keep drinking it. When you stop drinking it, you're no longer under its control. But watch it. The word filled here, it means to be being kept filled. It's not this one-time prayer. It's his power and his control is just continuing in my life. It's being kept filled. Watch this. As much as you are no longer under the influence of alcohol because you stopped drinking, hear me, the Holy Spirit who dwells and remains within you, he's not going anywhere. He's pitched a tent. But if you are not giving him control, right, if you are not reading and you're not praying and you're not in the Word of God and you're not in your time of worship and praise and you're not keeping your relationship with him tight, then you're no longer under that influence of the Holy Spirit, so to speak, as we would see from alcohol. And then we've walked in this place. It's not about how much I have of the Holy Spirit. I have all the Holy Spirit I'm going to get, 100%. He pitched a tent in my spirit. He dwells within me in this temple. It's a matter of how much control I've given him and me keeping that pipe wet. I think many times the pipe has gone dry. We've lost our desire. We've lost that relationship. We've lost our first love. We've lost the intimacy. Or we just flat out want control and we just do it ourselves. Church, when the subject of being filled, it is the topic of who controls who. It's that topic of keeping the pipe wet and that relationship with the Holy Spirit. So when you look at the big idea to this, it's a matter of where we're at today, right now, right now. Have you let your pipe go dry? Can I ask you, how are you in Jesus? How are you in Jesus? Are you walking in this place of surrender? Can you say, man, I am being kept filled. I am filled with the Holy Spirit. I am walking under his control. I am exercising the spiritual gifts. God is doing a great work in and through me. It's amazing. It's beautiful. And I have surrendered myself to him But listen, for all of us, there are seasons that we want to, the flesh wants to show up when we pull back. And we're no longer, he's still there 100%, pitched to 10. But there's the fight within our flesh of who's in control. And it's built off of our relationship and our time with him and our love of him. Love him with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. It's love. Where are we in this today? Come on, if you would just stand to your feet and bow your heads as we close. I don't know if he's just going to sing, and I want this to be a moment. I know we're past due, but I'm glad to be through with this series. But I just wanted to make things so crystal clear today. The Holy Spirit, whom is God by his Spirit, reigns and dwells within you if you are a believer. He pitched a tent, man. He's not going anywhere. You got all of them you're going to get, but it's a matter of walking out in his fullness. Man, just bow your head just for a minute. As Olivia's singing, I just want you to ask you the question, God, where am I in this? God, what have you spoke to me today? Do I need to rekindle afresh again? Do I know I need to surrender things in my life to you? Do I know that? If I've been selfish, if I've been living for me, if I've been wanting more control, and in this moment, you can give it over to the Lord and say, it's just time. It's time to surrender. It's time to say, Holy Spirit, you lead. I follow. The Holy Spirit, I know that you've pitched a tent. I know that you remain and I know that you dwell, but I'm asking that you would be the forefront and that you would lead and that I would follow. And today, that I would have a fresh filling, be being kept filled today.